Now that we've seen how to do linearization for differential equations and difference equations of one variables, we'd like to do it for things with multiple variables, for systems. The trouble is that we did Taylor series in one dimension, and we don't necessarily know how to do Taylor series in higher dimensions. So this video is about higher dimensional Taylor series, and that'll give us the tools we need to do higher dimensional linearization. So, reminder of what's happening in one dimension. We have a derivative, and a derivative is a limit of the change in the output divided by the change in the input. We often write it as a limit as h goes to 0 of f of a plus h minus f of a divided by h. But since it's the limit of the change of the output divided by the change of the input, the change of the output is roughly the derivative times the change of the input. So the output is roughly f of a plus f prime of a times x minus a. And of course, that's really just the first term in a long series. If you want to get the exact answer, you add infinitely many terms. If you want to get a better answer than one term, you add two terms, three terms, four terms, five terms. Okay, so we have all the terms in the Taylor series. So the sum as n goes to infinity of the nth derivative at a divided by n factorial times x minus a to the nth power. So far, so good. Now, if you had a function of several variables, you can't just take the derivative, you have to take partial derivatives. I'm going to use the notation partial j of f to mean partial f with respect to xj. And we do that by going off in the ej direction. We change the jth variable, but none of the other variables, minus f of x, and we divide, see how the function changes as you move in the ej direction. Divide by the change in xj, and take a limit. And then we put all the partial derivatives together to make a vector called the gradient of f. It's a derivative with respect to x1, x2, x3, all the way through xm. And by the way, why am I writing this as a column? Because vectors are columns. If you want a row, that's the transpose of the gradient, and that's convenient to have, and we'll call that df. Okay. So if x is very, very close to a, then we have the expansion that the change in f is approximately the gradient dotted into x minus a, or if you prefer, it's the row df times the column x minus a. Okay. Now, we could do more terms. I just wrote the gradient dotted into x minus a out in coefficients. It's the derivative in the ith direction times xi minus ai. That is the ith component of x minus a. And then you sum as I goes from 1 to m. So this is the gradient dotted into x minus a. And if you want the second order term, you need to take second derivatives, derivatives in the I and j directions, multiplied by the change in x in the ith direction, the change of x in the jth direction, and multiply by a half. When we only had one variable, that was the second derivative times x minus a squared. I and j were both 1. When we have multiple variables, we have a lot of terms here. I and j both go from 1 to m. They're allowed to be different. They're allowed to be the same. You can have third derivatives, and you just have to take the third derivative times x, the change in xi, the change in xj, the change in xk, and you divide by 3 factorial, and you keep going. So that's the full complete Taylor series in n dimensions. But we don't actually need the full Taylor series. We only care about first order for linearization. So now we get to the heart of the question. We're really interested in vector-valued functions of a vector. And a vector-valued function can be written as m scalar-valued functions, one on top of the next. And if you want the derivative of the vector-valued function, you take the derivative of f1, derivative of f2, derivative of f3, derivative of fm. So derivative of f1 was a row. You put all these rows together, and you get a matrix. So df is a matrix where the first row is all of the derivatives of f1. The second row is all of the derivatives of f2. The last row is all the derivatives of fm. A matrix, not a number, a matrix. Okay. So that gives us our expansion. If you want to understand how much a function has changed, you have to say how much has f1 changed, how much has f2 changed, how much has fm changed. And the amount that f1 has changed is the gradient of f1 times x minus a. The amount that f2 changed is the gradient of f2 times x minus a. You put them all together and you get this big matrix df times x minus a. In other words, if you want to know what is f of x, you take f of a plus the derivative of f of a, that's a big matrix, times x minus a, and then you have all the higher order terms. So if you compare what we had for ordinary functions of one variable, we had f of a plus f prime of a times x minus a. This behaves the same way, except this is a vector, is equal to a vector times a matrix times a vector. This was just a number is a number plus a number times a number. If you think of the derivative as being a matrix, then it's really the same formula.